Mr. Barcone, it's time to start class.
Thank you, Christina. Hey, good afternoon, everybody, and a happy and healthy Tuesday to you, wherever you may be. Hey, let's start off the period right now. Before I even get to anything at all, I'd like to do just a quick check-in with you in the chat box, everybody. Scale of 1 to 10, privately to me, privately to me. I've done this all day long. Tell me, how's your day going? 10, hey, it's a great day. It's been good, enjoyable, interesting. Weather's nice. I feel wonderful. Privately to me, one the other way, please, in the chat box, just so I could see your numbers. And of course, always feel free to pass, but I would like to hear from all of you checking in right now. If you don't have a number, just say pass, everybody, right now. Keep going. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 10, 15. Keep it going. It's going well so far, but not a number. Okay, fine. I'm looking at your numbers popping up here privately. Did I get everybody? Looking through here, you know me, 7 or better, I consider a win. Period 6, your numbers are all over the place, it seems. I've got some 10s, I've got some 9s, I've got some at the other end. Looking at an average here, tough when there are this many numbers and my math skills and all. But it's looking like it's averaging out somewhere around a 6 or a 7. I say a 7 is a win. 6, I'm not so sure. So it's somewhere on there. You know, FYI, if as I've told you guys before, if there's anything that I can do for those of you who are recording less than a 7, you know, at the very least, let me know. I'm not saying I can do what you're requesting. I'm not saying I can help out. But if you are less than a 7 and it's a consistently less than a 7, at least I'd like, if it's something that I can do on my end here, as far as this class is concerned, to help you elevate that score, to feel a little bit better about the class and the experience, school in general, I'd be more than willing. Certainly can't even begin to go down in that direction unless I have some idea of what the issue is. So let's take a look now. Thank you very much for sharing with me like that. Let's take a look at today's agenda. As you can see, we are going to answer 5 of the key questions. But in essence, what is it that we're going to be talking about? What is it that we're going to be looking at? And since this is period 4, and since on Monday, yesterday, we started this whole discussion of the first industrial revolution, what we're really looking at is the history of women and the history of immigration during the first industrial revolution. That's basically what all of this boils down to. At break, we'll take a look at a wonderful 1960s Beatles song, Blackbird, brought to us by Sophia today. Unfortunately, I was unable to find a live version of the song. You know, I like to put that YouTube live version in front of you. Instead, I have a live version, lead singer of the Beatles, one of the two major composers of their music, Paul McCartney. But I believe this is out of the 1980s, maybe even out of the 1980s. Beautiful sound, beautiful video. I think you'll very much enjoy. And of course, our normal PBL period at the 29-minute mark all the way through to the end today. So let's take a look at the announcements before we dig in. Is there anyone still needing to take a makeup test? If so, please see me at the break, or better yet, just email me. Let's change that around, but just email me. I'm understanding that the makeup test opportunity time had elapsed. And so I'll just let me know and I'll extend that period for you. So in any event, let's get started with the work we need to do today. We're going to call up the slideshow here. Christina, let's see, that didn't quite work. Let's try it again. There we go. Christina, are you seeing the slideshow right now by any chance? Anybody, Nash, or not Nash, but anybody else seeing the slideshow?
Oh, yeah. Oh, we see the slideshow.
Yep. Excellent. Great. Okay. So I'm going back out here for a second, and I want to go to slide 100. I believe it is. Let's go to slide 100. That's where we'll start. Okay. So let's pick up where we left off yesterday. So we have a little lead in to what we're going to be talking about today. Let's recap a little bit about the Industrial Revolution, but then at the very same time, a little curveball I need to throw at you. I have to have you add a question, key question number 33. This question is simply worded, what was the market revolution? What was the market revolution? Okay. So we're going to tie all this together right now in the next 2 to 3, 4 minutes. Let's do this. Yesterday, we talked about the fact that period four represents this period 1800 to 1848, the birth of America's first industrial revolution. And in that regard, we defined what is an industrial revolution. And that wasn't complicated, going from work by hand at home in a shop to work that takes place in a factory by way of something called a machine. Essentially, that's what the Industrial Revolution was. But to really understand the revolution, we need to go further. We have to talk about where some of these factories were located, especially in this period of time, 1800 to 1848. And as we mentioned yesterday, and all of this will tie together here as we go through the slideshow today, they were mostly located in the Northeast. Why not in the South? Because as we talked about, one of these inventions of the Industrial Revolution, in essence, gave rise, infinite more rise, to the fact that cotton would be king in the South, that the South was predominantly going to become an agricultural zone. Sure, a few factories down there, but nothing like what we saw in and are going to see here with the first and second Industrial Revolution in the North. So again, you know, what was the revolution? Where were these factories placed? We have another question now. Who at first worked in these factories? And as we talked about yesterday, and again, we're just recapping here, this particular key concept was suggesting that it was Americans, English speakers, especially men and women. In other words, the first people who really worked in these factories, who produced the work, we're not talking immigrants. We're not talking people who speak a foreign language. It was Americans, and it wasn't just men. It was women. And so we have to take note of that. And then further, as the key concept suggests, that when these men and women were working in these factories, it represented a fundamental change for them, because now they're coming from the farms and they're no longer relying or having to rely on semi-subsistence agriculture. And we defined and explained that term yesterday. Now here comes the big catch, okay? It says, instead they supported themselves producing goods for distant markets. All right, let's focus on that for a second, by defining the term market revolution. So your question number three, what is the market revolution? Let's start by defining each of the operative words, revolution first, then market. A revolution in this context means nothing more than a major change, a sea change, a drastic change, a day and night change. But what is a market? Now, my experience has shown that when I ask you guys over the years, what is a market, and or you answer APUSH multiple choice questions related to the market revolution, write short answer questions related to the market revolution, or even long essay questions, you only get the word market half right. You tell me, well, it's where people buy stuff. But what you have to keep in mind is a market is also where people sell stuff. So what was the market revolution but a major change in how people bought and sell stuff? And for you to understand what that change is all about, you need to focus here on this word distant markets and ask yourself, well, what's the opposite of a distant market? The market revolution brought in the concept of distant markets. Markets where buying and selling takes place over and can take place over distance. Well, the opposite of that is a local market. So think about this. Before the 1800s, before the first industrial revolution, before the market revolution, if you made something and you wanted to sell it, basically you walked down the street and you sold it in a local market. If you wanted to buy something, you walked back down the street to that local market. And chances are, again, before the Industrial Revolution and the Market Revolution, you probably bought a good that was produced by somebody locally. But with the Industrial Revolution, with the Market Revolution, changes in transportation and so on, especially, you now not only had the ability to buy and sell goods at a local market, But if you made something, you could produce it for a distant market. But you could also go to your local market and purchase something that had been produced at a distance. And that is what the market revolution is. And that is what I'd like to see in your answer to question 33. So now to bring that back to the Lowell Mills and to women, women not only with this industrial revolution got to work in factories, a major change for them. But look at what appears after the semicolon. They also got to go increasingly to the local market to buy goods that came from distant markets and in their factories produce goods for distant markets. So look how many different questions we're answering in regards not only to the question of what was the Industrial Revolution, but also in regards to the question of the history of women, especially at the outset of the Industrial Revolution. Now, fun question to ask, and oftentimes gets asked by way of APUSH and others, is what were some of the earliest factories? In other words, what did those factories produce? Well, there is a reason that we focus in on this Lowell Mills factory. Let's flip this over here. You know, one reason, obviously, is to reinforce this notion that most factories in the early part of the Industrial Revolution, they were located in the Northeast. Sure enough, that's where your Lowell Mill factory was located. But now look at this image. What were these early factories, a good percentage, a good proportion of these early factories, what were they producing? And as you can see here, the answer is cloth. And as another key concept made clear, we looked at it yesterday, some of the earliest factories, the earliest innovations, American innovations, Industrial Revolution, were in terms of textile manufacturing. I want to now to move this off of this slide just a little bit, and I want to go to slide 106. We looked at the picture of the Mills girls yesterday, and now let's go to slide 106 and this question of what is this cult of domesticity? The point to be made here, as you can see, is that in this period of time, during the market revolution, during the early years of the Industrial Revolution, beginning in and around the 1800s, there were various individuals who increasingly challenged the cult of domesticity. Up until this point in time, let's talk about English speaking females. What have we learned? Go back to the very beginning of this class. Go back to period two when we learned about English colonization. What are some things we learned about English speaking women? One of the things we learned was that the English brought their women. Not so true with the Spanish, lesser extent for sure, and definitely not so true with the French. What did we learn about English speaking women when they got here? Well, their job for the most part in those first 100 or so plus years plus was to take care of matters domestic. In other words, take care of matters that were in the private sphere. See where I'm circling here? In other words, take care of matters that had to do with the family and with the house, whereas the man could have one foot in the private sphere, certainly had a say there, but he also could venture out into the public sphere, the public space. And so what was true about women up to the 1800s? Well, there was this cult of domesticity. Your job, women, stay focused on the domestic, the private sphere. And sure, we saw a period of history that seems to suggest there was an exception to that. And if I asked you by way of the chat box, my guess is many of you go, oh yeah, we're talking about Republican motherhood, where women in the War of Independence actually fought in battle, spied on the British, served as camp followers. We learned about how they ended up being responsible for the teaching of their children, or increasingly became viewed as the person who should teach their children, Republican values. And so that's not to say that it was 100% domestic, It started to change, but generally speaking, there was this cult of domesticity, and the Industrial Revolution, the market revolution in that period of time, those notions were challenged. So if you think about what we just talked about, you're looking at the slide in front of you, question number 19, cult of domesticity, what is it? And question number 20, explain what this whole paragraph means, I now think you can do. But let's go one step further. We are now going to go to slide 59. And let's see. Wait, I don't know if I can do it this way. Hold on. Sure, I can. Slide 59.
In AP US history. Oh,
sorry. That was the Sultana. There we are. Good. So one great bit of evidence in support of the claim that between 1800 and 1848, the cult of domesticity was challenged. Women were little by little being thought of as being able to go into the public sphere is this thing called the Seneca Falls Convention and the related Declaration of Sentiments. Now, the Seneca Falls Convention took place at the end of the time period four that we're looking at, 1800, 1848. Well, what was the Seneca Falls Convention? Looking above at the key concept, it was the start of the first women's rights movement. That's what it was. It was, if you will, the first time in history that women collectively together stood up and, look at the language here, sought to create greater equality and opportunities for women. Specifically, what did they do? Well, they went to this place called Seneca Falls. And you see it on the map here. And if I asked you, hey, what of something that we talked about in this class, something famous, is located very close to Seneca Falls? And we decided to slow the pace of this presentation down a little bit and ask you, like I've done before, to give me your answer in the chat box. My guess is, based on what we talked about yesterday, a very healthy percentage, you would say, the Erie Canal. So what was the Seneca Falls Convention? It was a gathering here in New York near the Erie Canal. What did women do there? Well, there's an image that tells you what they did. They sought greater equality by standing up, speaking, sharing, and then take a look here. I'm going to underline this. You might need to move a little bit closer to your screen. They ended up producing this document called the Declaration of Sentiments, Declaration of Sentiments. And as you can see, it wasn't just the ladies who signed this thing. It was also, there were men. And what did this Declaration of Sentiments say? Well, the second bullet point there brings it home for you. It was modeled after the Declaration of Independence. Given the amount of time that we spent looking at the Declaration, the way we went through it word by word up to a description of the string of offenses that the colonists accused the British tyrant, brute, wretch of having engaged in, my guess is that you've got to know what this Declaration of Sentiments said. And so now, just to back this out, here we are. I believe we have now really quickly taken care of question number 14. What was the Seneca Falls Convention? If not, here's a slide for you that you can look over to further give you information for your key questions. And of course, I believe there's also a very good 6-minute and 15-second history video that I strongly suggest you take a look and learn from. Now, having said that, we're going to go to slide 110. And we are going to take a look at something else here. Okay. So this Industrial Revolution had an impact on women. And you need to be able to explain what that impact was, just as I tried to explain it to you here right now. But as this Industrial Revolution moved forward, a very interesting thing happened. Remember, we said at first these factories It was American men and women who worked in there. But as we get into the 1800s, 1830s especially, something very interesting happens in Europe. In two countries, Germany and in Ireland, certain events take place. They make it very difficult for young men there to feel as if they have any kind of future. There are what we call factors that push Germans out of Germany, push the Irish out of Ireland. We call them push factors. And in period five, we're going to take a little closer look at the specific push factors. Here in period four, we just introduce you to the term push factors. In any event, the Germans and the Irish are pushed out. But where are they pulled to? In other words, what are the pull factors that get them in large numbers, as you can see, large numbers of international migrants, that means immigrants, move to the United States? Well, the answer is the Industrial Revolution and this vast amount of farmland that I'm going to show you in just a second. So what you have to understand here is during this period of time, Germans and Irish, what we call the first major wave of American immigration, come to the United States. And you have to be able to talk about where did they settle? Where did they settle? What did they do when they settled there? And interesting enough, you also have to explain where did they come from? And it's not good enough to say Ireland and Germany. For the sake of APUSH, you have to understand what Ireland and Germany have in common. So I'm going to put my cursor right now here on Ireland. And I'm going to move it like this. And now you can see my cursor here, and the red you can see Germany. We're going to go back again. Cursor here, Ireland. Move it over here, Germany. So now that you see that this is Ireland, this is Germany, what do the two have in common? Well, the answer for you is they are both located in Northern Europe. And so the point to be made here is it wasn't just the Irish and the Germans who came, but it was two people from Northern Europe who came. And now as to the question of where did they settle, not the best map here. I wish I could find better, and I think maybe this year I'll commit myself to finding better. But the point to be made by this map is still a good point. The Irish settled along our eastern coast. The Germans settled west of the Appalachians. One unfortunate thing about this map, other than the silly references here, is in the Irish, to a large extent, settled in the northeast. So this map doesn't really reveal proportionally where most of the Irish went. They settled in the northeast. So what was pulling them there? And I think you can deduce this now. It was those factories. So what did the Irish do when they got here in these large numbers? They moved to the cities because that's where the factories were, and they went to work in the cities, in the factories, oftentimes agreeing to work for less than the women did, thus resulting in many women, in essence, once they'd been given these factory jobs, being forced to go back home, a return, if you will, to the cult of domesticity. The Germans settling west of the Appalachians, we talked about this. If I asked you, what is this territory, region of America called in the chat box, I would hope, based on our discussion yesterday, that many of you could very quickly say, oh, that's the Midwest. And so what did we learn about that geography? It's farmland. What did the Germans do there? They farmed. The pull factor, cheap farmland. The pull factor up here was factory jobs. And so having said that, we have now, in essence, answered question 21 and 22. We have begun this exploration, German immigration, Irish immigration. I have a wonderful video here that talks more about this, produced by my friend Adam Norris, immigration, and it's going to talk about 1830s, 1840s. As you can see over here, Germany, Ireland, in his slides, he's going to make reference to the fact that there was great political instability in Germany at the time. In other words, there was this factor that pushed the Germans out. Ireland later into the period is going to have a potato famine. We're going to talk more about that in period four. Look at what he does here. Where did they settle? Irish in cities, Boston, New York, Germans on the frontier, the farmland. And then he's going to talk about the influence of Cincinnati and so on, but we're going to do it like this. So when you think about Germans settling, you recognize because they came west of the Appalachians, well, what was west? And we've been talking about this since the beginning of the year. This amazing river, the Ohio, that flows into this equally amazing river called the Mississippi. And the areas are suggesting not only where many of these Germans settled, but where they developed thriving communities, prospering communities. And then again, that word I love to use so much, flourishing communities. And I love to use it because it was Thomas Paine, as I've said to you when we looked at Thomas Paine, Common Sense, it was Paine who in Common Sense said, it is not only common sense that we should now get our independence from this tyrant, wretch, brute called the King of England. But he tacked on to it this other thing. He said, it is also common sense that if we do this, we will flourish. And indeed we did. He was right on two scores, Thomas Paine. So last thing I want to do is just have you go back to this video. I would like you to watch the video on your own to, again, reinforce everything that I have presented here. Plus this additional point, as you can infer from the title of the video that Adam has here, that as this immigration took place, and especially German immigration into the farmland of the Midwest, there was increasing conflict with the Native American. And the word you know that needs to come to mind, the word that we've talked about so often, what was the source or the cause of this conflict? Answer is encroachment. So we've taken care of question 19, 20, 14, 21, and 22. We've also addressed question number 3. Christina, how am I doing on time?
Yeah, I think it's time for a break. So
let's do our break. Thank you, Christina. Okay. And I will just back this out like this. There we are. And enjoy.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these broken wings and learn to fly. All your life, you were only waiting for this moment to arise. Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these sunken eyes and learn to see. All your life, you're only waiting for this moment to be free. Blackbird fly, blackbird fly into the light. Dark black night. Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Take these broken wings and learn to fly. All your life, you're only waiting for this moment to arise. Blackbird fly, blackbird fly into the light of a dark black night. Blackbird singing in the dead of night. Won't you take these sunken eyes and learn to see all your life. You're only waiting for this moment to be free. You were only waiting for this moment to be free. You were only waiting for this moment to be free.
Thank you.
All right, so we'll stop the share here. And as you can see from my background, now I have the Lowell, a picture of the Lowell Mills there. And you know, it'd be really interesting if I asked you a short essay question or even a long essay question of related to the history of these Lowell Mills and what all you could tell me about, not only in terms of the women, but in terms of what came after, what came before, long-term effects, short-term effects. Be curious to see what you could do. All right. Is there anybody who has any question at all about the work, about your PBL or anything like that? So what I'm going to let you do now is spend the remaining minutes of the period, 20 minutes or so, on your PBL. FYI, I'm Carolyn. Actually, I want to meet with you real fast, and I forget who else is working with you on this, but remember, Monday, I'm going to start meeting with you, giving you a grade on progress of your pre-production manual, your script as well, just letting you know what I'm seeing, what I'm thinking, and then we'll go from there. We still have a long way to go before it's due, but we're going to give you some kind of progress check. All right, I'm going to turn off. Let's see.